To kick things off, we have Antoine Vanderly showing us a cool new way to use Swift Reduce. Well, at least it was new to me. I'd never seen it used this way, so I was like, oh, that's cool. I want to share that. So higher order functions in Swift, you know, filter, map, reduce, you probably learned these pretty early on in your Swift career, right? You've seen this, where the basics of reduce is to combine a whole bunch of elements into a single value. The most common example, right, is summing up an array of numbers. Say you're building a shopping cart and you have a bunch of items in that cart and you want to add up the total price of all the items. Reduce is perfect for that. I'm sure most of you have used that before. Now, what I wanted to share was I thought this was a cool new way to create a dictionary with reduce. He says, let's say you have an array of people and want to group them by the first letter of their name. Here, the Swift reduce method shines in its versatility. So you have your array and you use the new reduced into, and that will take this array and create a dictionary. As you can see here, the M with an array of Mike, A with an array of Antoine. And again, this version uses the reduced into, a mutable variant of reduce, which again, I didn't know existed, so pretty cool. And he's sharing other use cases as well, like counting occurrences of things in array. Again, you're using that reduce into, and then you can keep a count of how many dogs, how many cats are in the array. Flattening nested arrays, to be honest with you, I'm not sure how this is different than flat map. Maybe someone can explain that to me. And if I'm honest, I haven't looked into it more. I'm sure it's just a simple ChatGPT prompt away will tell me. But he also says, you know, should you always use reduce? Like, it is elegant and expressive, but it's not always the most readable option, especially if you're unfamiliar with those, you know, functional patterns like filter, map, reduce, because the syntax is a little different than typical Swift. The Swift Tokyo conference was just a week or two ago, and they already got all their talks up on YouTube. So if you're like me, and had a bunch of FOMO seeing everyone post about their trip to Tokyo on Twitter, Mastodon, Blue Sky, all that stuff, well, now you can alleviate that FOMO a little bit by getting to watch all of the talks. And you can see some of the topics here, Swift, weirdness, traps, and fixes in Swift, great app design done quick, and many more. So definitely go to their channel, scroll through, pick out the videos you want to watch. You can see they're not crazy long, 16 minutes, 27 minutes, 20 minutes. So they're not like hour long talks, very easy to watch through. Definitely go check this out. In previous episodes of Swift News, we talked a lot about not storing your API keys in your app because it's pretty easy for someone with bad intentions to see what's in your app and steal your API key. Well, in this article, they show you how to inspect IPA files and secure your iOS app from common mistakes. So this is how it's done, basically. And I am not suggesting you go do this for all the apps and try to find API keys. That is not why I'm suggesting or sharing this. The reason being is because this is a great way to inspect your own app and see what you might be leaking out there. Again, things like your API keys or other sensitive information. And by doing this, again, you'll see just how easy it is to get an IPA file. And it's not even like you're hacking. You can use the Apple Configurator. It's an official app for managing iOS devices. You can download it on the App Store. So it's an official app from Apple. You can download it on the App Store. So you're not being like an elite hacker here. Of course, there are third-party tools, but using the Apple one, you can see how you can download an app, get the IPA file, and view it in Finder. You can see a folder structure like this. So aside from checking your own app for own security leaks, you can also see what's in other apps, like what frameworks they're using, etc. But again, here's the example. We said, you know, don't store your API keys in a configuration file in the plist. Because look, you can get the plist right there, just like that. And they give some warnings here. Don't add any sensitive data into the info.plist. It's not encrypted. It can be easily read by anyone. Again, you're not an elite hacker. It's an app you can download on the App Store from Apple. And like I just said, you can see what frameworks an app is using, what other resources are in there. Like this Headspace example has an accounts.json, but it's just a list of test accounts. And they said it doesn't work in production. There's more stuff with frameworks. Again, Headspace is using the Lottie framework. And because Lottie files are basically JSON files, you can kind of pull that out and see what animations are using, what assets are in the app, and then strings. This is another thing we talked about with the API keys. If you have your API key just as a hard-coded string in your app, look, macOS has a built-in tool called strings. Again, you're not an elite hacker here, that you can extract the strings from a binary file. So if you do have your API key as a raw string, you can easily pull out all the strings and find it. So like I said, the point of sharing this wasn't to teach you how to hack other apps and steal API keys. Don't do that. Come on, don't be stupid. It's to examine your own app to make sure you're not leaking anything. If you've never examined your own .ipa files, now's the perfect time. Stay curious, stay secure. Thanks for reading. So yeah, definitely do this on your own app. See what you're leaking. And if you are leaking things, fix it. Greg Eisenberg's a really good follow if you're interested in startups and, you know, where things are going with AI. So he put out one of his tweet threads that he puts out commonly, but I want to focus on number 9 because this made me stop and think. So he says, where are we going in the next 5 years with like AI and all that stuff? MVPs will need to feel complete on day one because if it works, someone will clone it with AI in 15 minutes. And I read that and I was like, oh yeah, Because that's the traditional, you know, startup or indie app advice is to, hey, get the earliest version of your product out there possible, get people using it, and then iterate from there. And that was good advice when the cost to build something, software development, was expensive. It was hard. It took a team to do it. Now, over time, like, the cost to build software is going down and down and down. As individual software developers become more productive, you know, powered by AI, or AI just does things, right? It's just faster and easier to build software. So, I don't know. What do you think? This is why I wanted to share this. Do you think the MVP is dead? That classic advice of, hey, just get a quick and dirty early version out and see if it works. Because if it does work, and it's just a quick and early dirty version, oh, that's going to get cloned very fast. I mean, clones are already rampant on the App Store with AI. As soon as something has a little bit of success, there's 18 different clones out there. So yeah, I kind of agree with this. I think the old MVP advice, like, is dead. I don't know. What do you think? Apple Search Ads has just rebranded to Apple Ads. I mean, the joke pretty much writes itself. And the reasoning is that, you know, ads are showing up in more places than just search. So calling it Apple Search Ads, you know, didn't feel very accurate. So anyway, regardless of the name, we got a great guide here from Ariel from App Figures on the Super Bowl blog. The ultimate guide on how to set up an Apple Search Ads campaign the right way. So if you've never set up an Apple Search Ads campaign, it can be confusing, right? Do you use basic? Do you use advanced? What about exact match or search match? How do you find what keywords you should target? So that's what this guide goes through. Now, I'm not going to go through and read the whole thing, but those are the main topics. Setting up the initial campaign. Again, do you use basic or do you use advanced? And basically, basic is where you say, Apple, take the wheel. Here's my budget, $100 a month, $1,000 a month, whatever it is. You show this to the right people based on your algorithms, Apple. You're basically just putting it in Apple's hands and you get no transparency into it. They just say, cool, we spent your $1,000 and, you know, you get like how many downloads and your cost per install and all that stuff. But you don't know like what people were seeing your ad, you know, what keywords were targeted. But that's where advanced comes in, where you can select, I want to target these specific keywords. You can set up negative keywords, so don't show up for this. And then you can bid higher on specific keywords. So advanced is where you get like all the power. Basic is where you're just like, I don't care, you just do it, Apple. And what's right for you, it depends on what your goals are. But that's the kind of stuff that you're gonna find in this guide, you know, selecting a budget that works. Search match versus exact match. So search match is where you say, hey, I wanna find a habit tracker. And Apple is like, okay, we'll do things similar to habit tracker. But again, the more fuzzy that is, the more your money gets spent in ways that you don't know how. You're kind of hoping Apple does that accurately. So Ariel always suggests exact match. But again, stuff like that, finding the best keywords. You can use ASO tools like App Figures, and then how powerful negative keywords are. So again, this is all about not showing up for the wrong person you want to show up for. So that's where negative keywords come in. That way your ads are being shown to the right people, so your money is being spent effectively and efficiently. So if you haven't run an Apple Search Ads, I'm sorry, Apple Ads campaign, or even if you have, this is definitely a great refresher. Check out this article from Ariel. Are you tired of me talking about AI yet? Like, that's kind of a half serious question that I genuinely want to know in the comments, because I feel like I featured it in the past 10, 20 episodes of Swift News. But it is obviously changing our industry and it's evolving very, very rapidly. So it's kind of hard not to talk about it. But here's an article from Bruno Rocha, how I'm using AI to improve my software engineering productivity and why it will not steal your job. So the foreword is, AI will not steal your software engineering job. And he says, recently my social media feeds have become full of people making predictions about how in X years, months, whatever, no software developers will exist, you know, that kind of stuff. But he says, if you look at who's writing these posts, and I've seen this too, you'll notice something interesting. They're either like executives who haven't done, you know, software engineering in a long time, or beginners with like not much experience. And I kind of echo this sentiment because I have not heard this sentiment of all code will be written by AI from people that are actually in the weeds, coding, building, the independent contributors or the indie devs. Because the people that are in there day in, day out, they're like, I don't see that happening. Because I like what Bruno says here. It's like, the problems with these predictions is that people are making them, for some reason, seem to view software engineering as nothing more than coding and closing tasks in Jira. You find the task, you code it, done. But the reality of software engineering is far more complex than that. There certainly is a good amount of coding, but it's extremely rare that problems a software engineer needs to solve are perfectly defined. More often, the job is not really about coding, but rather figuring out like what needs to be coded. And here's some questions, right? What problems are we facing now? What problems are we gonna face in the future? What are the current objectives of the company? What is the current state of the company? Like, what is most important for the users, right? There's so much that goes into like what to build, right? It's not just coding. And he says, the answers to questions like the ones above provide you with context to help you define how and when exactly certain problems should be solved. It's a critical aspect of software engineering, even for junior developers. The interesting part is the more senior you become, like the less coding you actually do. So my hypothesis for where this is going is that every software developer is going to have their own army of insanely smart interns that they can direct and command to do. But as Bruno said, you still have to know all these like big picture questions. It's not just, hey, code this perfectly defined problem. You have to figure out like what to solve, how to solve it, and even when to solve it, like prioritize, triage. But here's some other use cases, right? Getting simple tasks done quickly. It's kind of what I talked about with the army of very, very smart interns. There's a lot of tasks in programming that are just tedious, boilerplate, or very straightforward, very defined problem. AI can handle that, no problem. Other use cases are, well, just, I'm not gonna hit all of them here. Like asking questions that are too specific for Google. You know, if you get that rare, weird error in Xcode and you can just copy that whole error message, put it into ChatGPT and it tells you like exactly what's going on and how to fix it. Like that is amazing because, you know, most likely that specific exact error message isn't solving Google. Sometimes it is, but most of the time it's not. So searching for very, very specific niche things, it's great for. But anyway, the main reason I wanted to share that was I thought this thought was interesting that we talked about a lot up front was how that, yeah, AI is great for the perfectly defined existing problem set, but all these like, we'll call them meta questions, at least in the current state of things, we still need the software engineer to guide the AI. Maybe that will change, who knows, but it's just hard for me to believe because of the perfectness, that's probably not the right word, of how software has to be, right? It's like this crazy intricate puzzle that if one piece is off, oh, there's a bug or it doesn't work right or everything falls apart. And AI can get like 98% of things right, but again, if only one or two pieces are off, like it's, you know, the whole thing comes crumbling down. So that's why it's hard for me to believe that AI will just completely do everything. You know, I think we're gonna be guiding an army of AI interns and fixing the bugs, reviewing the code. That's just where I foresee things going. That wraps it up for this episode of Swift News. See you in the next one.